from me to all of you for being here. I know that you've seen the posters around school, and in some ways I hope that the lecture lives up to its title, but in other ways I certainly don't. So we shall see how it goes. What I'm going to try and do over the next 30 minutes or so is to offer some reasons why I believe that art can and should save the planet. I'll be drawing on some of the research that fed into my book, Waste Matters, that was published around this time last year, and I might have mentioned it to one or two of you once or twice over the past year. But don't worry, I'm not just going to stand here and read it to you. Enjoyable as that would be. So, it should come as no surprise to anyone in this room that the planet needs saving. We live in an age of unprecedented environmental crisis, and the melting Arctic ice caps are just one visually striking symptom of that. The human impact on climate change is debated by some, including, at the moment, some very high-profile figures, but surely it's undeniable that humans contribute to air pollution, deforestation, soil erosion, and species loss on a massive scale. According, for example, to the WWF website, an area of forest equivalent to the size of 48 football fields is lost every single minute around the globe. Every minute. So we are living in what the Nobel Prize-winning chemist Paul Crutzen has called the age of the Anthropocene. So Greek scholars out there, Anthropos, what does that mean, anybody? Anthropos, yes. Man, okay, so we are living in an era that, unlike former geological epochs, is an era in which the dominant influence on climate and environment is humankind, is us, right? And there's something that all of us do every day, multiple times a day, that I think is the most significant driving force behind the contemporary, the present day environmental crisis. You put stuff in the bin, you flush stuff down the toilet, you throw stuff out, and when we're feeling especially virtuous, we sort things, we sort our recycling. Okay? So, how often do we think about what happens next? About where our rubbish goes? You have a sense that it goes somewhere, somewhere that probably doesn't smell very nice, but actually, we are in a habit of not deliberately not thinking about what happens to it. But that's where I want to go today. And luckily, there is a growing group of artists, photographers, dancers, novelists, poets, who are already there, and they're willing to show us around. So I'm going to start by claiming that one way in which the arts can save the planet is by providing a radically new perspective on our environment and the ways in which we are polluting it. Has anybody seen this image before? Okay, Alex. And what can you tell us what type of bird that is?
Isn't it a gull?
It's an albatross. Okay, it's an albatross chick. So this is an image from a series of photographs taken by the American artist Chris Jordan in the Midway Atoll, which is a really small, like a tiny group of islands in the North Pacific Ocean, 2,000 miles from the nearest continent. And each year, tens of thousands of albatross chicks die from ingesting plastic that the mothers scavenge from the Pacific Ocean, believing it to be food. So you may have heard the Great Pacific Garbage Patch, the Gaia, the floating Gaia, that's where this word, which you probably can't see, comes from. So as you might be reading in the newspaper, we know that with overflowing plastic waste, and much of it is literally scattered across the surface and just below the surface, of the world's oceans. And birds, like these albatross, think that it's food, they feed it to their young, the young ingest lethal quantities, they die and they decompose, and an artist, Chris Jordan,
has taken a series of photographs. So this isn't staged. He's just been there, he's documenting it. And that is the plastic you can see inside. So I don't even know what that is, but we've got kind of a bit of the hair, like a hair slide. We've got what looks like bottle tops. And there are tens of thousands of albatross like this. And he started this project in 2009, and he's continuing. So this, his work and his art project, which is possibly unlike kind of nature or environmental art projects that you might have thought about before, tries to show us this new perspective on this emblematic example of current day pollution, right? And he says that looking at this image is like looking into what he calls a macabre mirror, a horrific reflection. In the same way, he says that the albatross can't distinguish between the plastic waste and what nourishes us. He thinks that humans in the present day, because of consumerism, because of the desire to have more stuff and to keep throwing it away without thinking about it, we can no longer distinguish between what is good for us, what nourishes us, and what is actually killing us and our planet. And his photos are trying to make us aware of that. So, don't worry, we get to some more lighthearted examples later. We'll get there. So if this is what he calls a macabre mirror, a horrific reflection, I also want to look at a shadow sculpture. Okay? So I don't know how well you can see that. So this piece is by the British artist Tim Noble and Sue Webster. Anybody seen this before? Anybody seen anything like it before? So it's one of them, a number of shadow sculptures that they create. So, and not all of them are on the theme of rubbish, but their very first show in the 90s was called British Rubbish. So they are kind of concerned with these issues. So you've got in the foreground here a pile of rubbish accumulated by the artists themselves over the 6 months that it took them to make this piece. We've got two taxidermy seagulls, so two stuffed seagulls. And then, what you can see in the background, when a light is shone on this pile of rubbish, you've got an accurate self-portrait of the artist silhouetted there against the back wall, drinking wine and smoking. So what's going on here? What Noble and Webster do with this piece of art is kind of flip our usual way of seeing things. So instead of the rubbish being the thing that's hidden and thrown away, it's moved into the foreground. And their lives, right, their lives relaxing and drinking wine, become the negative space. So what they're trying to do, they're trying to highlight how this kind of comfortable lifestyle cannot be detached from this production of rubbish. And, of course, as the seagulls flag up to us, the impact that that has on the environment. So I really love, I mean, I love this piece, I think it's really effective, I think it's very witty. And I also want to draw attention to the title of the piece, Dirty White Trash. So you may have heard the term white trash. It's more commonly used in an American context. It's a derogatory term to refer to kind of white working class Americans, kind of associated with trailer park culture and all the stereotypes that go with that. But by referring to themselves as the dirty white trash, Noble and Webster are taking that derogatory term, and again, in the same way they flipped our vision, they're flipping our language. They're applying it to themselves and saying, actually, you can't just denigrate people and call them trash. We're part of this. Okay, so if what we're trying to do, what I'm claiming that the arts can do, is radically shift our perspective, make us look at the environment and look at the planet differently, we also need to think about the many, many people who can't ignore their trash, actually. The millions and millions of people for whom a pile of rubbish wouldn't show, wouldn't illuminate a kind of nice, refined lifestyle, but actually, well, not refined necessarily, but a comfortable lifestyle. The millions of people who actually live off, live with, and literally live in trash. And it's those people and their stories and their representations, the portrayals of them, that I mostly focus on in ways that matter. So I'm kind of concerned with those sidelined stories. And I think these million people, obviously now, accumulate in slums at the edge of cities or within cities all around the world. There are now so many people living in these conditions that the urban scholar Mike Davis has suggested that we now live in what he calls a planet of slums. So for him, they are the dominant feature of the 20th and 21st century in the way that we live. This is a photo. And if you know, anyone want to hazard a guess where this is taken? Yeah? Bingo, yes. It's a favela in Rio, okay? So well known to be a mega city, a global mega city with enormous slums. So there are obviously deprived, poor areas in the first world, right? We can go to London, any city in the UK, and there are poor areas. But there are many, many more of them, and on a far, far greater scale in the developing world. So in other words, like places that are not as rich economically and powerful as the UK. And Mike Davis is kind of this, he's studied a lot of these slums, and he's come to the conclusion that the principal function of the third world urban edge remains as a human dump. Now, my students would all have recognised, hey, seems to be a metaphor. Just don't annotate that. But actually, what is most shocking about our planet of slums is that this isn't a metaphor anymore. Slums these days are literally dump sites for humans and for things that are both equally treated as rubbish. So it's not a figure of speech. These people are literally being treated as rubbish in the same way that their environments consist of rubbish. So I suggest that what art can do is put these places on the map, make us think about them, make us think about, hang on, how did they come to be? What are the reasons behind these places? So they map these places. So what I do in Waste Massive, I look at a bunch of different types of texts. I look at Ghanaian detective fiction, Caribbean novels. I look at Indian literary non-fiction, American films, and so on. And what the common thread through the different works that I look at is a concerted effort by the various artists to dignify the lives of the people that live in these slums, and in doing so, kind of also restore value to these environments that are treated as wastelands. So I'm going to now talk through just some quite eclectic examples from the book, but they're not entirely random, but kind of, in the hope that's kind of something will pique your interest. So another photographer, Peter Hugo, is a South African photographer, and he took a series of photographs that he titled Permanent Error. And does anyone know where this photo was taken? Anyone want to make a guess? Is it Whitney? No. Okay, so these are taken in the capital city of Ghana, Accra, in a slum called Agbogbloshie, which is infamous for being the largest e-waste dump site in the world, electronic waste. So what happens here is you get electronic goods from usually the developed world, including the UK, so fridges, microwaves, any electronic goods, laptops, computers, desktops, right? They get exported to Ghana. They're purchased in bulk by those that can actually kind of afford to buy lots of them at once. And then there's this intricate recycling chain. So they're broken up and broken up and broken up. And at the bottom of that recycling chain, the lowest of the low, are these guys. These are the guys who live in and around this dump site, this slum. And what you can see them doing here, you can see some of the electrical appliances there that have been smashed up. You can see, right, a pretty, to our eyes, shocking lack of any kind of health or safety equipment. There's no goggles, they're not even wearing sleeves, they're not wearing helmets, right? And you can see the flames. Those are burning at an intense heat. These are electrical plant fires. Plumes of smoke, clearly incredibly toxic. And in the very background, you can see kind of the city there. So it's a pretty depressing image, but what I love about this series of photos is the fact that the young men that Peter Hugo took photographs of, the way that they are looking at the camera, they're demanding that when we look at these photos, we acknowledge them, that we don't just kind of cast them aside and continue to ignore them and ignore what happens to our mates. So it's a way of bringing them back into our consciousness. You know, they're not posing. They've given their permission to be photographed. And I just think this is an incredibly striking visual image. So you can see these are copper wires. So these guys will burn, well, they're electrical wires, so they'll burn like old telephone cables to extract the copper. So you can imagine the danger just from burning open market. But also, most of these guys die from cancer in their 20s from inhaling the toxin. And this isn't kind of small scale. This is happening now. This is happening. And it's kind of there's a direct connection between what they are doing and the way in which generally in the West, the developed world, we don't necessarily give enough thought to our waste. And photographers like Peter Hugo are encouraging us to do so. Okay. So I thought I'd better talk about book. So I thought I'd talk to you about Chris Abani's novel Graceland, which again, you know, the photos we just looked at, they give us a snapshot of these so-called wasted lives. What the novel form allows artists and writers to do is give us a much more developed sense of what it might be like to live in a slum. So this is just the cover image, but the main character in Chris Abani's Graceland is called Elvis. Yep, he's a young Nigerian. He's named after Elvis Presley, because his mom was a fan. And he lives in a slum in Lagos. And we hear in the very first scene of the novel that he wakes up to the smell of garbage from refuse dumps, unflushed toilets, and stale bodies. Right? A bit like walking into English Street sometimes. Okay, and we also learn in that first chapter of the novel that the slum that he lives in is built on really unstable ground. And this is a real slum, but this is Chris Abani's fictional description of it. So, half of the town was built of a confused mix of clapboard, wood, cement, and zinc sheets, raised above a swamp by means of stilts and wooden walkways. The other half, built on solid ground reclaimed from the sea, seemed to be clawing its way out of the primordial swamp, attempting to become something else. So, again, what you all have noticed is the wonderful metaphor there, this sense of the slum clawing its way out of the swamp like some kind of ferocious, strong animal that is not going to be put down, is not going to sink back into the sea. So what Chris Abani is doing is showing us the hidden strength of the slum and the slum dwellers. Gives you a sense of what the slum is like, so you can see kind of the houses on stilts, so partly solid ground, partly on water. It's considered wasteland. It's considered to be inhabited by people who are waste, who are worthless. And during the course of the novel, what happens is that the government realizes, oh, hang on, that slum that these people have spent years reclaiming from the swamp, now prime real estate in the middle of the city. Well, what are we going to do about it? I know. We're going to bulldoze this one, reclaim the land, and sell plots of land off for development. So the government, the Nigerian government, so this is the setting in the 1980s, they instigate Operation Clean the Nation, so they suggest that they're cleaning up the city, and indeed, they do bulldoze the slum. What Chris Abani does is document the grassroots resistance to that slum clearance, and even though it doesn't succeed, the slum does get bulldozed, at least what Abani is able to do is dramatise the efforts of the people to resist it, and to show the richness of their lives, even though they are precarious lives that are lived in precarious environments. And just in case you think Chris Abani may, there's all that slum clearances of this nature that kind of just bulldoze slums. Those are happening, again, on a daily basis in different cities around the world. That is a kind of a frequent way that cities deal with the problem of slums. So they just kind of, again, are just kind of think they're clearing waste, but where does it go? So, obviously, I've given you some quite somber examples so far of how the arts can help us kind of save the planet by raising our consciousness. But if all that the arts does is just make us feel bad about ourselves and our lives, then it's not going to have the impact that we need the arts to. We need to be motivated, we need to be inspired. So the last example that I'm going to talk about is a dance project by the American choreographer. Her name is Alison Orr. And in the film, so there's a documentary film by Andrew Garrison, and Trash Dance is the name of the dance project. So he films the project as it takes shape. And what happens in Trash Dance is that Alison Orr, she's from Austin, Texas, and she collaborates with the sanitation crew, the sanitation team, so the public workers in the city, and she shadows them over a 9-month period. So she goes out with a different crew. So she goes litter picking, she goes street sweeping, and very memorably, she goes out with the dead animal collection crew. There's a dedicated team. All they do is clear, so they collect domestic animals that have died and dispose of them. And they also clear, as we see Alison Orr doing, they clear carcasses from the road. And we see this kind of very fragile dancer gingerly scooping up dead animals from the road. But believe me, it's quite funny the way that it's presented. Okay, so the trash workers, or the waste workers of Austin, Texas, they're largely Hispanic and African-American in what is a predominantly white city. So again, we've kind of got that overlap between living and working with waste and bearing a disproportionate responsibility for looking after the environment and being a minority. But they're incredibly good humoured, they're incredibly hard-working, and they kind of talk and they describe their lives during the course of the documentary. By the end, the outcome of the project is that 24 of these waste workers participate in a public dance performance that she has choreographed. What I also love about the performance is that she incorporates 16 sanitation trucks, rubbish trucks, into the performance. So you can see some of them lined up here. And in one of the most moving sequences, I'm going to try and show you a clip from it in a minute, there's a solo performed by the crane operator. So the crane is a truck that's got a crane on the back of it for particular kind of operation. And that is the worker who drives that truck. He's called Don Anderson. He's a very heavy set guy you can see him here, so this is in the front. And he tells us that, you know, his love outside of work, he loves barbecuing. He is not your most obvious choice for someone who's going to participate in some sort of experimental dance. However, he does, and I will try and show you the clip. this dance project, and I would recommend all of you to watch the documentary Trash Dance that traces it from its origin through to the public performance, is the fact that it shows us this sector of the population who are these really unlikely custodians of the environment. They look after the environment. These waste workers do more to care for the urban environment than a lot of other people that live in this city. And she dignifies them in the same way that novel Graceland or that series of photos lend dignity to the lives of waste workers. That's what Alan Moore does. But even more important than that, in terms of what the arts can do, this was a public performance. It created this moment of connection between the performers, the waste workers, and the people that came to see it. And in that moment, it did something special as a piece of art, but also as a direct impact of the success of this art performance, the waste workers got a pay rise. So it shows, if you need kind of tangible outcomes, that pay rise was a pretty important outcome for this crew. So I've talked about how the arts can change, can radically shift our perspective on waste. And the practices of kind of waste production and disposal that we routinely ignore. I suggested that the arts could put on the map the slums that we're perhaps unaware of. I talked about how the arts dignifies those who work with waste and also the spaces, the polluted spaces that they work in. And I hope that you get a sense of how a project like Trash Dance is this kind of optimistic moment of connection and collaboration, and shows us that we can find environmental inspiration in really unexpected places. And just the last minute really is to just think, well, what does this do for us as students and as teachers? Now that you've heard this talk, what do I want you to take away from it? What do I want us to do? Have I sparked anything? So I want us to be attentive to the ways in which we look at and we think about the natural world and the environment. I want us to be conscious of the assumptions that we make and the things that we leave out of our reflections. And really, I want to say that, above all, look to the arts, both as a complement to and also a counterpoint to the sciences, for ideas and inspiration about and for knowledge and understanding of environment. Because if we are going to live more sustainably, then we need to be sustained. And I think that is what the arts can do for us. So I will stop there. No one ever complained of the lecture being too short. And if you want to go back to any of the slides or the images or ask any questions, I'm happy to do so.